I want to welcome everyone to Colonial Heights United Methodist Church. Whether you are worshiping with us in person this morning or online this afternoon, we are so glad you're here. This morning we're going to be receiving communion, and we'll be doing that from our seats today. The COVID numbers, as you know, are rising and getting higher, so we just felt it was safer for everyone to go ahead and stay at their seats today. If you did not receive the communion cup and bread, they are at the back. If you'd like to step out now and get one, that way you'll have it at time. And if you're at home, you may get bread and juice or whatever is appropriate that you have at home, and you may join us when we have communion later today. I have several announcements for the life of the church. Our youth are going to be meeting at the home of Phil and Kay Brown this afternoon for an outdoor pool party. That's at 5 o'clock. We are going to have a Bible study at 5:30 on what United Methodists believe, and I've already heard from a couple of folks who were planning to be there that they're not going to be able to come. So if you are going to come, could you please see me after worship and let me know? Otherwise, we will postpone that for another time. Then on Thursday at 11, the J. Ray Stewart class is having their monthly luncheon. You'll need to let Julia Diker know if you can be there, so there'll be enough tables, seats at the tables, and enough tables for you as well. Want to let you know this morning we have several sick, and so you'll notice that we are veering from the worship guide this morning. Stephen is sick with a sore throat, as is the Piper, the little girl of Jacob Calico and Tasha Chansey, who are going to join this morning. They'll be doing that next Sunday when she's feeling better and they're able to come. So let us open with a word of prayer, if we would. God, you know all things. And on mornings like today, when we are taught how to be flexible, how to stay in the moment, to go with your spirit and wherever life leads, still our spirit. Center us on you, for you have our attention this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The celebration hymnal, verses 1 through 4. We're singing it. Song shall rise to thee.
saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which wert and art and evermore shall be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see. Only thou art holy, there is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity. Holy, holy,
prayer, and in observance of September the 11th and the events of that horrific day 20 years ago, I want to offer this prayer, followed by the Lord's Prayer. This is a prayer written by Reverend Will Shuey, who is at Shades of Grace in Kingsport that you've met. I want to share it. Let's pray. Merciful God, may you bring healing and hope to this very broken and hurting world. We thank you, our loving Lord, for granting strength to all of those who are on the front lines and for shining light through all of those who seek to make and pursue peace in this world. We ask your forgiveness for the hatred in our own hearts. We ask your forgiveness for hatred in our world that pursues such horrific acts and destruction of human life. You have called us to pray for our enemies. We lift up all people this day, those that we agree with and those that we disagree with. We ask you to heal a very broken world through the name and the power of Jesus, who came to make this world whole and who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I also want to let you know that I failed to do this during the announcements, but we have, the homecoming team was going to meet today, and we have made the decision to postpone homecoming till at least the spring. As you are well aware, the COVID numbers are rising and affecting more and more people. We've heard from two people in the congregation. Phil's lost someone he works with to COVID this week. And Don Reed shared that Butch Peccolo, that works at the University of Tennessee, lost his wife to COVID this week. Ask that you continue to be in prayer for researchers, for all those dealing with the disease, and for all of those who are yet to be vaccinated.
In singing hymn number 640, Sweet Hour of Prayer, we'll sing both verses.
Drive-through meal. Over 70 hot dogs went out Wednesday evening. And we have regulars that come now. They know that we do this on Wednesday and Saturday once a month. And we're making new friends. And we're hearing about what a blessing we are being the body of Jesus Christ to them, and they are blessing us through gifts of love and praise and prayers. And it is all because of someone's generosity. So we thank you. Let's receive our morning offering. Before Gene shares the scripture, I will let you know that the Apostle Paul is preaching the majority of the sermon this morning. So she will be bringing to you Romans chapter 14 from the Message translation.
I always did want to preach a sermon. My kids will say I've done it many times.
Above you
and proving your worth to the people around you. So let's agree to use all of our energy in getting along with each other. Help others with encouraging words. Don't drag them down by finding fault. You're certainly not going to permit an argument over what is served or not served at supper to wreck God's word among you, are you? I've said it before and I'll say it again. All food is good, but it can turn bad if you use it badly. If you use it to trip others up and send them sprawling. When you sit down to a meal, your primary concern should not be to feed your own face, but to share the life of Jesus. So be sensitive and courteous to the others who are eating. Don't eat or say or do things that might interfere with the free exchange of love. Cultivate your own relationship with God, but don't impose it on others. You're fortunate if your behavior and your belief are coherent. But if you're not sure, if you notice that you are acting in ways inconsistent with what you believe, some days trying to impose your opinions on others, and other days just trying to please them, then you know that you're out of line. If the way you live isn't consistent with what you believe, then it's wrong. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Let's say that you make the best apple pie in the whole world. Absolute best. And you've decided that you're going to enter it into the contest, baking contest at the TVA and I Fair. Who do you want to judge that pie? Do you want somebody to judge your pie that likes coconut pie better than anything else? Or do you want somebody to judge your pie that can't stand apples? Who do you want to be your judge? What if you're a woodworker and you create beautiful wooden bowls like the one that we have for our communion out front? And you decide you're going to enter that in the craft section of the TVA and I Fair. Who do you want to be your judge? Do you want someone that does metal works to judge your bowl made of wood? Who do you want to be your judge? Who do you want to be your judge? Someday, if I keep practicing my quilt. Some of you have seen my tops on Facebook. I've got to where I can do the tops, the piecing. Oh, Lord help me. I tried to quilt a great-great-grandson's playmat yesterday. It was my second attempt at actually quilting those sandwich pieces together. It was not pretty. But maybe if I keep practicing, one day I'm going to put one of my quilts in the quilt show. That's on my bucket list. Now, who do I want to be my judge? Do I want somebody who's never even started a sewing machine to judge my quilts that I've practiced all my life, adult life anyway, to learn how to do? Who do I want to be my judge? Someday we will all be judged. Someday all of our lives will be judged. If we're Christians, the way they're going to be judged is how we have lived and our lives been transformed to follow the ways of Jesus Christ. Who do you want to be your judge? Who better to judge the Christ-like life than Jesus Christ himself? Correct. According to Paul, no one has the authority, right, or ability to judge you except Jesus. I thought I'd get at least one amen. Paul says he doesn't even judge himself. Now, why is that? Quite simply, because we don't even know our own selves the way God knows us. Only God knows the human heart. Isn't that what we've been discussing for weeks now from the lectionary text we've been sharing? Jesus said, remember, don't be so concerned with what's on the outside. Worry about what's on the inside of the cup. James said, your faith should transform your heart in such a way that the heart then changes everything that you do. Can anyone judge what is in your own heart? We deceive ourselves to avoid shame or guilt. We will manipulate our own thoughts to let ourselves off the hook or to justify our actions. We can deceive ourselves. Now, sure, we might be seeing evidence of the Christ-like life in ourselves, but we can't see the heart, can we? Has any among us ever done good works just to get praise by human beings? Just to be in the limelight, or maybe just to prove to other people we really were a Christian? Not awful intentions, but not flowing from a pure heart. Who has the ability to judge our intentions? Who do you want to be your judge? Who's qualified to be your judge? Jesus. Period. Jesus. I want to ask here, how does it feel when you are judged by anyone? Who are you qualified to judge? No one. So then why do we continue to do it? I'll go back to the very beginning of the book once again and say what I've said before. It's always important when you age out that you tell people you know you're repeating yourself. They have a little checklist before you go to the home, how many times you can forget something or repeat yourself. I know I'm repeating myself. We go back to the beginning of the book, to that fruit, eating of the apple, and the whole reason we ate from that apple is because we wanted to be like God and judge for ourselves good from evil, thereby usurping God's authority to do that for us. And it's called original sin. It is what missing the mark means, is sin. And we did that because very first thing we did when we could judge good from evil was what? We decided for ourselves that naked was bad. We'd been naked that whole time. And all of a sudden, when we have the power to decide good from evil, all of a sudden, naked is bad. Naked is evil. And God, in his mercy, clothes us. A very dear friend and an astute disciple of Jesus Christ, when I gave that explanation for original sin, said, but Rhonda, she was just exasperated with me. But Rhonda, we all judge. We cannot help ourselves. Exactly. That's why we need a Savior. It is ingrained into the human being from the time we are born, from our first breath of life. We are deciding for ourselves what is good and evil. And in the process, judging ourselves and other people almost continuously. Which is why we need a Savior. Which is why we need Jesus, who is merciful, who understands, who is forgiving. Who else do you want to be your judge but Jesus? See, the problem as Paul's laid out for us, is that Christians do not judge. When we judge ourselves or others, it is sin. So understanding that sin means to miss the mark, when we judge, it separates us from God. We're raising ourselves above God, are we not? When we put ourselves in the seat of judge, we're taking God's seat away from God, and we are sitting in it ourselves, separating us from God, separating us from other human beings, because if we're the judge, well, we must inherently in that is believing that we are in a position, i.e. better than them, to be able to judge what they're doing. And then we separate our own selves by the very nature that a Christian does not judge. When we judge, we are condemning ourselves, is what Paul is saying. By the very act of judging, we convict ourselves of not being a Christian. Do you see the problem? It's really important to make sure we stay seated in the right seat. Now, as you know, Dell is our resident attorney. In all your years of being an attorney, has anybody ever got up from the gallery and got up and sat in the judge's chair? No. And what would happen if anybody was brazen enough to do that? Woe be unto them. That's those. Woe be unto. Absolutely. I think they might be escorted out of the courtroom, would they not? So who are we as human beings to exert our authority and take the seat of God and judge another human being for whom Christ died? And if there are any exceptions to for whom Christ died, will you please be sure and see me after worship and let me know? So if we do it and we cannot help ourselves, we have access to the Savior Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit working to transform our hearts in the Christian life of following Jesus to intentionally not be judged. We can give the apple back. That's the power of the cross. We can give the apple back. We can take the burden of being the judge off of our own selves and everybody else through a very rarely known Christian discipline as well. It's called apatheia. Anybody ever heard of apatheia? It comes out of the Stoics. It basically means radical acceptance of all that is, radical trust in God that all will be well, and we can kind of take our hands off of the steering column, off the gavel, off of things. Not that we do not care. Apatheia doesn't mean not caring, but it is a loving trust in a loving Savior that all will be well in the end, even if we don't see it now, even if we don't see it in our lifetime. Trusting that all will be well and we don't get to be judged. Apatheia. I will tell you, I am not an expert. I bought a book about 12 months ago with every intention of reading about apatheia. I have a good friend, and she and I both decided we both needed to exercise this Christian discipline we'd never heard about. Quickly have 7 quick steps, and I will put them in the newsletter for you so you don't have to memorize them, because I've just found them in recent moments. Number 1, steady your nerves. I most need this when I'm driving my car. Number 2, also needed when I'm driving my car, control your emotions. Control your emotions. We are not created to have our emotions control us. We're supposed to control them. Practice objectivity. 4, practice contemptuous expressions. Now, I had to think about that. Yeah, I did what Jenny did. What? Practice contemptuous expressions. This will ruin the prime rib comment for you. It's seeing all things as they truly are. that wonderful filet I've been craving for days is a dead animal. Ultimately, it's a dead animal. It's realistic. And it will probably turn me against eating that filet in the next 24 hours. Number five, alter your perspective with the A-L-T-E-R, and you can also spell that A-L-T-A-R if you would like. Alter your perspective because we choose how we look at things. No matter what is going on, we can choose how we are going to respond. We can't choose what happens. We can choose how we respond to what happens. Number six, live in the present moment. Not in the past, not in the future, right here, right now. And number seven, look for the opportunity. Look for the opportunity. What is God revealing? Even though it might be COVID, can we look for the opportunity? Can we look for the opportunity as Christians in the midst of a pandemic? Wow. What better time to show the world what love looks like than when the world is in such need of love and care and healing? Look for the opportunity. To have apatheia can sometimes come as a grace, a gift from God, just like that. But most of us have to be intentional. We have to be disciplined. We have to even know that it exists to be able to have apatheia, to give the apple back so that we are not judge of the world or ourselves. Do you want to know some really incredible news this morning? Jesus is our only judge. Not only is Jesus our judge, Jesus is the defense attorney. That's good news. Let's pray. Loving God, sometimes your words sound so easy. Challenge us, convict us, recreate us. Through your Savior, Jesus Christ, through teaching us, for learning about how to be apathetic, how to not be judge of the world, how to trust you that all things will be right. In Jesus' name, amen. Today we are going to receive communion. I'll remind you to open the bread first, to end with the bread first, and then to turn it over and open the end with the juice. You can find our liturgy for communion on page 12 in the United Methodist hymnal. Christ is our Lord. In other words, Christ as our Lord is the only one who has the right to judge us. He invites to his table all those who love him, who earnestly repent, to turn and go a new way from sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were still busy judging everybody else and ourselves. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, God, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night that Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ so that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. When I sent Jean the scripture text, after a few minutes had gone by and she had read it, she emailed me back and she said, "This isn't about food, is it?" No, it's not. May the peace of Christ be with you as you share in his body and his blood. Thank you. we judge ourselves or another or allow others to place judgment upon us, we are sitting in the wrong seat. We are allowing ourselves and others to usurp the authority that only God has to be judge. There are times that I have encountered people and experienced things that I was really sure that person was going to be in hell. Maybe you have. One of my Hobbesisms is that if there is someone that you know for sure is going to be in hell, or that you want to make sure you see in hell, does that say more about you or them?
Join in singing Blessed Assurance, found on page 572 in the Celebration Hymnal. We will sing the first and third verses.
Blessed Assurance.
God's eye. No one has the right to judge the apple of God's eye but God. Thanks be to God. May you go from this place knowing that Jesus is both judge and Savior and defense attorney for you. In Christ's name, amen.